Good morning, students. Today I am going to start online classes, Physics Chapter 2. Myself, Om Mohan Saxena. We will start the Gauss theorem. Now, in this Gauss theorem, we basically use it for calculating the electric field because of the different charge bodies. Due to the point charge, we have already discussed the electric field in the previous chapter, but now in this chapter we will discuss about the electric field due to the different charge bodies of the different shape. So before going to the Gauss theorem, we should know some term, that is the area vector. Till now we know that the area is a scalar, but the area is a vector quantity, and the magnitude of that vector is the amount of that area, and the direction is perpendicular outward, drawn normal. Suppose this is an area, its magnitude is A, and this is a area vector, and the value of that area vector is n cap. N cap is a unit vector perpendicular to the plane of the area, and this is a magnitude. So this is the area vector which is drawn perpendicular outward. Now after that, there is a one more term that is known as a solid angle. Till now we have studied about the plane angle, that is the angle between the two lines which are drawn in a plane, that is a plane angle, and its unit we use as a radian. But in the case of solid angle, it is a three-dimensional figure. Suppose this is a sphere or a closed figure, and this is any area on that, a small patch of area dA. When we join the every point of the circumference of dA with the center, then it will like a cone shape, and then this area is known as a solid angle. And this is, suppose the radius of this sphere is R, and this area is dA, then the value of this solid angle is given by dA upon R square. So this is the magnitude, and the unit is steradian, S-T-E, steradian. This is the unit, SI unit for the solid angle. So the area on a spherical surface subtend an angle in the form of cone at the center of the sphere, and that angle is known as a solid angle, and its value is given by dA upon R square, and it is represented by d omega. D omega is a small angle for that. Now if we suppose expand this small surface throughout the closed surface, means if it is a spherical surface, then for whole closed surface, the surface area will become 4 pi r square. This is the surface area of the sphere. So if we calculate the solid angle subtended by whole of the surface area, that will be 4 pi r square upon r square. This is the surface area, means this is the small area dA. Now if we expand this total area throughout the surface, so now we'll calculate that how much angle the total spherical surface subtend at its center. So the total surface area of the sphere is given by 4 pi r square divided by r square, it will become 4 pi. So the angle subtended by whole of the spherical surface at its center is given by 4 pi. Now if we generalize that, if any point lies inside a closed surface of any shape, then the angle subtended by closed surface of any shape at any point inside it will be 4 pi. This is the general term for that, generalized version. So whatever be the shape of the closed surface, and where is the, whatever the position of that point, but the position should be inside that surface, then that closed surface subtend an angle of 4 pi at the interior point. Now after that, one more thing is that we have studied that the angle subtended by dA at a point P, that is given by d omega, and this length is r, and this area is dA. Now here we can say that This area is perpendicular to the line joining P to the center of this surface. Means this line is perpendicular to this area. Then we use the formula, that is dA upon r square. Now if we consider another case, that suppose this is an area and this is the point where this has to sustain the angle. Now in that case, what will be the angle sustained by this area dA on the point P? This length is r. So here we can say that this is a r vector and this is the area vector, and the angle between them is theta. So now here we can say that this line is not perpendicular to this area. So if we take a perpendicular component of dA, suppose this angle, if this angle is theta, then this angle will also be theta. So this component, which is perpendicular to this line, that is given by dA cos theta. Now this is a perpendicular component with this line, so this angle is now given by dA cos of theta upon r square. So this is the solid angle sustained by any surface at the point P when the angle between the area vector and the vector r, which is the vector along the line joining the point P to the center of that surface. So this is the general formula. We can apply formula for that. In this case, we can take, this is a dA also as well as r also. So here the theta is taken as a 0. When we put the value of theta 0, cos 0 will be 1. So it will again, we'll get the same thing. Now the term is electric flux. Flux basically measures the number of electric line of force crossing through an area placed in the electric field. So how we measure it mathematically? Now it is a surface integral. This sign A means this is a sign ADA. It represents the surface integral, means we integrate throughout the surface. So the surface integral of electric field through the entire surface is represented by the electric flux. It is given by phi E. So basically, if we take a small area dA on any surface, it is placed in the electric field like that, then the total flux linked with that surface is given by d phi, and that is given by E dot dA. Means this is the scalar product of the electric field as well as the area vector. So the electric flux link with a small area element is the scalar product of the electric field and area vector. Now if we extend it, means we have to calculate the flux link with throughout the whole area, then we integrate it. So it will become the total flux link with the whole surface is given by surface integral of electric field over that surface. Now if the angle between E and dA is theta, then it will be given by E dA cos of theta. As we know that A dot B is equal to AB cos theta. So E dot dA will be equal to E dA cos theta, where theta is the angle between E and dA. Now E cos theta integration ADA, so it will become E cos theta into A, or we can write it EA cos of theta. So this is the formula which we'll use while solving the numerical problem. Now in this case, see one of the diagram. Suppose this is an electric field, this is a uniform electric field, and one of the diagram surface is this, another surface is this, and one more surface is this, like that. This is the electric field. Here, this is the direction of electric field over here, and area vector is given in this direction. So here theta is taken as the 90 degree. Means whenever the surface is parallel to the electric field, in that case theta will be taken as 90 degree, not 0. Now here you can see that the electric field is this, and this is the area vector, because area vector is always taken in outward direction, so theta will be taken as 0. Now here the surface is perpendicular to the electric field, but the theta is 0, not 90 degree. Now here suppose this is the electric field E, and the surface makes an angle theta with, or you can say surface makes an angle alpha with the electric field. So what will be the theta? Theta is the angle between the electric field and normal to the plane, that is the area vector. So this will be taken as a 90 minus alpha. Means in the case if the surface makes an angle alpha with the electric field, in that case we will take theta as a 90 minus alpha. Means if it is asked that suppose the surface is there which is inclined at an angle of 60 degree with the electric field, in that case when we have to take the theta will be 90 minus 60, that will be 30, will take over there. Now after that, this we have discussed. So the what is the value of maximum and minimum flux? Whenever a surface is placed parallel to the electric field, in that case theta will be 90 degree, in that case the flux link with that surface will be maximum. Means if the surface is parallel to the electric field, in that case theta will be equal to 90 degree, and in that case EDA cos of 90, that will become zero. This is the value of the flux. Means when the surface is parallel to the electric field, in that case the no flux will be linked, that is a zero flux. But if the surface is perpendicular, in that case theta is taken as a zero, so in that case the flux will be EDA cos zero, and that will be EDA, that is a maximum flux link with the surface. In that case the maximum number of line crosses that surface. Now after that it comes the Gauss theorem. Now what is the Gauss theorem? According to this theorem, the electric flux link with any closed surface is 1 upon epsilon naught times the net charge enclosed by that surface. Means the electric flux link with any closed surface E dot dA. This circle indicates for the integration for the closed surface, and it is equal to Q upon epsilon naught, where Q is the net charge enclosed by that surface. This is the Gauss theorem. I'm repeating again, the flux link with any closed surface is equal to 1 upon epsilon naught times the net charge enclosed by the surface. Net charge means suppose this is a any closed surface and this is plus Q1, this is minus Q2 plus Q3. So the net charge will be given by Q1 minus Q2 plus Q3, like that. If there is no charge enclosed inside the Gaussian surface, then the flux link with that surface will be zero, because the value of Q will be zero in that case. Now we are going to prove the Gauss theorem, and proof is like that. This is any surface, arbitrary surface. Here is a charge Q is placed over here, and suppose this is any point P which is at a distance r from here. So this is the direction of electric field and this is the direction of area vector. Area vector is always taken perpendicular to this surface, and E is along this line joining from Q to this point. Suppose this angle is theta, so this area is taken as dA. So first of all we will calculate the flux link with dA, and that will be given by d phi is equal to E dot dA, and that will be E dA cos of theta. This is the flux link with this part. Now if the value, we calculate the value of electric field, we know that the value of electric field given at that point because of this charge will be 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught Q upon R square. This is the value of electric field at this point because of this charge. Now when we substitute this value, that will be given by 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught Q upon R square, that is the value of E, and dA cos of theta. Now we see that when this whole of the flux that is given by E dot dA, dA cos theta, that is the value of flux link with over here. Now the total flux we calculate, that is phi E, is equal to integration d phi. That comes out to be integration 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught Q upon R square dA cos of theta. Now, as we know that q upon 4 pi epsilon r is constant, it comes out r square also. Now here we'll get dA cos of theta upon r square. Now what is that? dA cos theta upon r square is a solid angle, so we can write this angle as d omega. So phi e will be given by, that is q upon 4 pi epsilon naught into, that is 4 pi. 4 pi and 4 pi cancel, because this is d omega. You'll write d omega over here, and the value of d omega, this is the solid angle subtended by the small part, and when we integrate whole of the surface, then this whole angle subtended by closed surface, that is always taken as 4 pi. 4 pi epsilon naught into 4 pi, that will be cancelled. So here we'll get phi e is equal to q upon epsilon naught. So this is the proof of the Gauss theorem. Again, listen here. This, when we substitute the value of e over here, we'll get this thing. Now this is for the small area. Then when we integrate for the whole of the surface, then we'll get the value that we put the sign of integration over here, put the value of e over here. Now q upon 4 pi epsilon is out, then dA cos theta upon r square will make a solid angle d omega when we integrate. So this value means the angle subtended by whole of the closed surface at q, and that will be given by 4 pi. So this is a proof of Gauss theorem. Now after that, there is a term Gaussian surface. Whenever we are going to calculate the electric field, we have to draw an imaginary closed surface. A very important thing for the Gauss theorem is that the Gauss theorem is applicable only for the closed surface. So whenever we are going to calculate the electric field through a charged body, then we have to draw a Gaussian surface. So Gaussian surface is an arbitrary, means self-chosen, arbitrary closed surface around that charged body which passes through the point at which we have to calculate that electric field. This is the Gaussian surface. The main property of the Gaussian surface that it should be a closed surface. It should pass through a point at which we have to calculate the electric field. And the shape of the Gaussian surface depends upon the shape of the charged body. Now, application. The first application, there is a number of applications. Today we'll discuss the first application. We are going to find out the electric field due to a point charge. So electric field due to the point charge means, suppose a charge Q is placed at a point A, and we have to calculate the electric field at a distance R at point P, which is placed at a distance R. So first of all, we'll draw a Gaussian surface which is a spherical in shape around the charge Q, and this Gaussian surface should pass through the point P. Now the next step is that we'll take a small area around P. So the area vector is dA and the electric field is E. So the flux link with this will be given by E dot dA, and that will be E dA cos of 0, because E and dA are in the same direction, so theta will be 0. So it will be E dA. Now we apply the Gauss theorem. So we'll put like that, phi E is equal to E dot dA. Now this will be integration E dA. So E integration dA. Now what is dA? dA means integration of this, means we integrate this small area element throughout the surface. The surface is a spherical, so we'll get the surface area of the sphere 4 pi r square. Now when we apply the Gauss theorem, so the value of phi e will be taken at q upon epsilon naught, and that is equal to e is equal to 4 e into 4 pi r square. So the value of e will be 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught q upon r square. So this is the electric field due to the point charge. One more thing, if a point q naught is placed over here, then the force experienced by that is q naught e, and when we put the value of e over here, we'll get 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught q naught upon r square. So this is the Coulomb's law. So here we have also derived the Coulomb's law from the Gauss theorem. So in this part we have discussed up to here. In the next part we will discuss some more applications of the Gauss theorem. Till then, have a good day. Thank you.